Welcome to this one sample hypothesis t-test video. We'll be conducting a two-tailed test and corroborating our results using confidence intervals. A t-test is a statistical tool used to determine whether there is a significant difference between the means of two groups or between a sample mean and a known hypothesized population mean. It's mainly used when working with small samples or when population standard deviations or variances are unknown. In our case, we'll be conducting a one-sample t-test, which is used to compare a sample mean to a known or hypothesized population mean. It helps to determine if the sample is likely to have come from a population with that hypothesized mean. Today, we're examining a claim made by a nutrition company about their customers' daily calorie intake. The company claims that the mean daily calorie intake of its customers is 2,000 calories. However, a random sample of n equal 21 customers shows a mean daily calorie intake of 2100 calories. That's the sample mean x bar since it was obtained from a sample. And the sample standard deviation s is 195 calories. We'll be testing this claim at a significance level alpha of 0.05. To conduct a one sample t-test, we need to assume that the sample is random and representative of the population, and that the population of daily calorie intakes is normally distributed. Now let's state our hypothesis. Since we're testing the claim that the mean daily calorie intake is 2,000, the null hypothesis is that the population mean mu equals 2,000 calories. Since we want to test if the claim of 2,000 calories is incorrect, the alternative hypothesis HA or H1 will be that the population mean is not equal to 2,000 calories. This is a non-directional or two-tailed test, since not equal means the mean could be less or greater than 2,000. Now, for one sample t-tests, the degrees of freedom DF are calculated as the sample size n minus 1. This is because we lose 1 degree of freedom when we estimate the population mean from the sample data. Since the sample size is 21, we have 20 degrees of freedom for this test. Using the critical or rejection region approach with alpha equals 0.05, two-tailed, and degrees of freedom 20, we can find the critical value using software or from a t-table. At the top of the t-table, we select alpha of 0.05, two tails, or 0.025, one tail. With degrees of freedom 20 on the left, we obtain a critical value of 2.086. Now, under the t-distribution curve, the critical region is divided equally into two tails. Thus, we reject the null hypothesis if our t observed or t calculated is less than negative 2.086 or greater than positive 2.086. And we fail to reject the null hypothesis if our t observed lies between those critical values. Next, to calculate the t-statistic, we use the formula x bar minus mu divided by the standard error of the mean, where x bar is a sample mean of 2100, mu is a hypothesized population mean of 2000, s is a sample standard deviation of 195, and n is a sample size of 21. Evaluating this gives a t-observed of 2.350. Recall that the decision rule states that we should reject the null hypothesis if observed t falls into these critical regions. Now, a calculated test statistic of 2.350 falls into the rejection region, as is greater than 2.086. Therefore, we reject the null hypothesis at alpha equals 0.05. Note that rejecting the null hypothesis doesn't prove that the alternative is true. It only suggests that the observed data is inconsistent with the null hypothesis. To interpret, we can say that at the 5% significance level, we have sufficient evidence to conclude that the company's claim of a mean daily calorie intake of 2,000 calories is incorrect. That is, the difference between the claimed population mean of 2,000 calories and the observed sample mean of 2,100 calories is statistically significant and not due to random chance. Specifically, the data suggests that the true mean daily calorie intake may be higher than the company claims. We can also use the p-value approach to make decisions about the null hypothesis. We reject the null hypothesis if the p-value is smaller than a specified alpha. While we cannot determine the exact p-value from the table, we can estimate it by going to the degrees of freedom 20 and determining where the test statistic 2.350 will fall. Since 2.350 falls between 2.086 and 2.528 here, corresponding to two-third alpha levels of 0.05 and 0.02, we estimate the p-value is less than 0.05 but greater than 0.02. Using software, we find the exact p-value to be 0.029. The p-value represents the probability of obtaining a sample mean as extreme as 2100 or more if the null hypothesis is true. Since this p-value is less than an alpha of 0.05, we reject the null hypothesis. Note that if alpha were 0.01, our p-value would be greater than alpha, and we will fail to reject the null hypothesis and say the result is not significant. Note that failure to reject the null hypothesis doesn't prove that the null hypothesis is true. It only suggests that the data or results do not deviate significantly from the null hypothesis. Now, let's construct a 95% confidence interval for the population mean. Note that confidence level and significance level alpha are complementary. So, the 95% confidence level here corresponds to a significance level alpha of 0.05, that is, 1 minus 0.95 equals 0.05. Applying a 95% confidence level means that if we were to repeat the sampling process numerous times and construct confidence interval for each sample, approximately 95% of those intervals will capture the true population parameter, which is the population mean in our case here. Using the t-distribution, the formula for constructing confidence intervals for a single population mean is given here as sample mean plus or minus the margin of error. T-star is the critical value with n minus 1 degrees of freedom, and s over square root of n is the standard error of the mean. The t-critical value for the 95% confidence is the same as the two-tailed critical value at alpha equals 0.05. Plugging in the values, we obtain a margin of error of 88.76. The lower limit of the confidence interval is the sample mean minus the margin of error, which gives us 2011.24. The upper limit is the sample mean plus the margin of error, resulting in 2188.76. Interpreting this, we can say we are 95% confident that the true population mean daily calorie intake lies between 2011 and 2189 calories. In practical terms, this means using this method, we expect to capture the true population mean 95% of the time if we were to repeat this sampling process many times. It's important to note that this specific interval we've constructed may be one of the 95% that contains the true population mean, or it could be one of the 5% that does not. We can also use these confidence intervals to corroborate our hypothesis testing decision. Observe that the hypothesized mean of 2000 calories falls outside our confidence interval. This aligns with our earlier decision to reject the null hypothesis, confirming that our result is statistically significant at the 95% confidence level. For contrast, if our hypothesized mean were 2150 calories, which falls within our confidence interval, we will fail to reject the null hypothesis. In this case, we will conclude that our sample data are not inconsistent with the hypothesized mean. It's crucial to remember that confidence intervals should only be used to make decisions for two-tailed hypothesis tests, not for one-tailed tests. This is because the confidence interval is symmetrical around the sample mean, which aligns with the nature of two-tailed tests. And that's it. We've shown how to conduct a two-tailed one-sample t-test using critical region approach, the p-value approach, and the confidence interval approach. Thanks for watching.